This morning, it is indeed an awesome opportunity to be among you, to share the word of the Lord, to share the word of the Lord. And the word is indeed active. It's living this morning. So welcome one and all to ReCharge Ministries, a place where the logos is action, where we're family-centered, where we have a servant's heart, and purpose must be fulfilled. I must let you know that this morning that the Easter season is, I would say, my most favorite time of the year. It is truly my most favorite time of the year. So you will see a lot of messages coming from me about Easter and about our Savior at this time of the year. And I'm gearing up for Easter Sunday. But in preparation of Easter Sunday, there are a couple key messages that I certainly want to share with you. And it is a part of the seven last words or last statements that Jesus made. And this morning is no different. Yesterday on another platform, Caribbean Live TV, I preached on I Thirst, and that is on our YouTube channel. So please go and listen to that message yesterday, I Thirst. And that was the fifth statement that our Jesus Christ made. And today is no different. Today will be the fourth statement that Jesus uttered while he was on the cross. And today's sermon is, my God, why have you forsaken me? My God, why have you forsaken me? Let's pray this morning. Most holy and most righteous Father, I thank you this morning for your outpouring. I thank you for your word, oh God, that you have imparted into my belly this morning, Father, so I can pour it out unto your people. Father God, this morning, I look to you, Father, who will be exalted this morning through this word. And so, Lord God Almighty, while I decrease physically, Father, you will increase spiritually this morning. And I pray, Lord God, that as you unload and pour out, and let your presence be made whole, be made known. Father, I pray this morning that your people will say, I receive, I receive. Lives will be transformed and renewed for your glory, Lord God. I pray that this word, Lord God, will be quickened, Lord God, in our spirit this morning. And I pray, Lord God, that when it's all said and done, we will say that it was good for us to have heard your word, Father. And I pray, Almighty God, that it will be transformative this morning. Have your way across this digital platform, Father. Have your way as your word go forward. And I give you all the thanks and all the praise. And I say in the name of the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Ghost, amen and amen, because it is so. Glory. Again, today's sermon is, my God, why have you forsaken me? And this morning's scripture is taken from Psalm 22. And Pastor Mark already read this morning before we went live, 1 through 22. But the only verse I will echo this morning will be Psalms 22, verse 1. And it reads as thus, my God, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me from the words of my groaning? Again, the word reads as the Psalms 22, verse 1. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me from the words of my groaning? So as I mentioned before, the seven last statements uttered by Jesus during the crucifixion, as recorded in the Gospels are, and I'm going to go down in order. the seven last statements uttered by Jesus during the crucifixion are recorded in the Gospels, and they are the first one, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. That's Luke 23, verse 34. The second is, truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. Luke 23, verse 43. Woman, behold your son. Son, behold your mother. John 19, 26 to 27. The fourth that we will expound upon today, my God, why have you forsaken me? Hallelujah. And in reference in the New Testament, it's also referenced in Matthew 27, verse 46, and Mark 15, verse 34. And we just saw it in Psalm 22, verse 1. The fifth is, I thirst, and that's John 19, verse 28. The sixth is, it is finished, John 19, verse 30. And the seventh one is, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit, Luke 23, verse 46. The scripture tells us that darkness settled over the earth about midday and continued for 3 hours. It was at 3 o'clock in the afternoon that Jesus spoke the words we will discuss today, which is, my God, why have you forsaken me? The crowd had grown weary of mocking Jesus. The darkness had quieted the crowd since they could see almost nothing. Some scholars believe that it was just like midnight at midday as Jesus hung upon the cross. So the crowd had settled down to wait for the dying men to pass away. Out of the darkness came a cry from our Lord that no doubt created an eerie moment, especially hearing his words coming forth out of the black atmosphere of darkness. Jesus cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Charles Spurgeon said that anyone hearing the voice of Jesus say that day could never forget what they heard. He felt the cry of Christ from the cross, from out of the darkness, would serve to haunt a person the rest of his or her life. Today, we cannot hear its voice speak those words. But let's consider for a moment what he said in the darkness that day and what it means to our hearts today. Jesus was covered by darkness, suffering under the weight of our sins, enclosed in a storm of pain and loneliness. Yet he died there on the cross for you and for me. I want that to rest on you for a moment. I want it to rest in your heart for a moment. Just envision the cry, my God, why have you forsaken me? The fourth statement uttered by Jesus as part of the last seven statements that he uttered on the cross. But before I delve into the meaning of Jesus's cry, my God, why have you forsaken me? I want to remind you of the three offices of the Messiah. Number one, Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus is the Messiah. The second is the Son of God. Jesus is the Son of God. And the third is, he is the God-man. So Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus is the Son of God. And Jesus is the God-man. He came to fulfill all the prophecies of the Old Testament. And as the Messiah, the Anointed One, he is prophet, he is priest, and king. I want to repeat that again. He came to fulfill all the prophecies of the Old Testament. As the Messiah, the Anointed One, he is prophet, priest, and king. And these are the three great offices of Israel in the Old Testament. And Jesus carries out these three offices perfectly for those he came to redeem. Theologian Herman Bovick said, this whole life of Christ in its prophetic, its priestly, and its kingly activities issued at last in death. In other words, the death is the fulfillment, the completion of the life. Simply put, Jesus came to die. And he himself was clearly conscious of it. Mighty God. Hallelujah. Jesus came to die. And he himself was clearly conscious of it. Now, your question is, how do I know this to be true? I'm always a question person, you know. How do I know this to be true? Well, Jesus begins teaching in the synagogue before returning to his home of Nazareth. And in Luke 4, verse 16, at his first public appearance in the synagogue of Nazareth, he applied the prophecy concerning the suffering servant of the Lord to himself. He was talking about himself. And there he reads a prophecy from Isaiah and claims that he has fulfilled it. My God. And when those familiar with him implied that Jesus has no place making such claims, Jesus himself implied that God would send signs to Gentiles if Israel refuses to believe. So this bold statement clearly and perfectly delineates that he was aware of the fact that he would be led as a lamb to the slaughter. He was the lamb that takes away the sin of the world. As noted in John 1 verse 29, the temple of his body was to be broken, but after 3 days, he will be raised again, as stated in John 2, verse 29, where Jesus answered and said unto them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days, I will raise it up. My God. So the reference to temple is Jesus himself. My God, as Moses raised the serpent in the desert, so according to the counsel of God, the man of God must be raised on the cross. My God, the man, oh my God, the man must be raised. The Son of Man must be raised on the cross. And this is uttered in John 3, 14 to 15, where it says, and just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the desert, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. Jesus was a grain of wheat in John 12, verse 24, which had to fall into the ground and die to bring forth fruit, which states, truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Hallelujah. We are reminded that the eternal Son of God
the second person of the Trinity, came to earth and took to himself a human body. He was born of the Virgin Mary. He lived under the law and kept it perfectly. He did this as the second Adam who represented us. Jesus lived the life we should have lived. And though he never sinned, he died the death we deserve to die. He willingly did this. He was born to die. But not just any death. It was a death that only he could die. And it happened once. It happened once and never to be repeated. It happened once and never to be repeated. As 2 Corinthians 5 verse 21 says, for our sake, he made himself to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. His death was no accident. It was a part of God's plan. His death was no accident. It was a part of God's plan. So if Jesus knew that he came to die, a sacrificial death of atonement for sinners like you and me, then why did he cry out on the cross, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Why? For many of you that like to ask questions and need an answer. So bearing the fulfillment of that was written in Psalms 22, verse 1a. Jesus on the cross at the ninth hour cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" The ultimate question is, what does this prophetic utterance mean? Because if he knew he was going to die, why did he say that? My God. Why have you forsaken me? If he knew, because his death was no accident. It was a part of God's plan. Well, let me answer that question for you. So here Jesus is referencing an Old Testament scripture. I just took you back to the Old Testament, because Psalm is in the Old Testament. Specifically quoting Psalms 21, verse 1. And it's essential to recognize that this psalm predates the use of crucifixion as a form of execution. I must let you know that. This psalm predates the use of crucifixion as a form of execution. Yet, remarkably, it vividly describes the circumstances surrounding Jesus' death, making it one of the most profound prophecies in the Bible. And on that day, Jesus spoke with deliberate and profound intent. I want you to know that. So Psalms 22, 23, and 24 together form a trilogy, meaning a set, a triad of profound truth. And collectively, they illuminate three significant phrases in the life and mission of our Lord. What did I say? Reading is fundamental, right? For all my rechargers, reading is fundamental. Connecting the dots is fundamental. So Psalms 22 speaks of his life, the rejection, the death, and the resurrection. Psalms 23 speaks of his leadership as a great shepherd of those who trust him as Savior and Lord. Psalms 24 speaks of his lordship and of the time when he will take us to live with him in heaven. Yes. So Jesus was quoting this passage purposely for he knew the reason for his death. One can biblically discern that when Jesus felt deserted, he turned to the word. My God, hallelujah. One can biblically discern that when Jesus felt deserted, he turned to the word. Just as he did when he was tempted by Satan in the wilderness, he now turns to the word of God for strength and convey truth to everyone who will listen. Glory, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And we can glean from this that when we see no light and find no answer, we turn to the word of God and trust what he says. My God, hallelujah. Glory. Mm-mm-mm. So when you and I see no light and find no answer, our job is to turn to the word of God and trust what he says. When life makes no sense, we find wisdom in God's word. Oh my God, that's why I say you need to open up your Bible on the dark days in your life and you will find some light there. Glory, hallelujah. When you're going through, it's not a time to shut up and lock yourself away. Go to the source. Go to the source. So like I said, when Jesus felt deserted, he turned to the word. He turned to the word. Just like when he was tempted by Satan in the wilderness. He used the word. He used the word. And you and I need to turn to the word just like Jesus turned to the word of God for strength. And he's conveyed truth to everyone who will listen. The second is a separation. So in the entirety of scripture, my God, why have thou forsaken me? This stands as a soul question. Jesus directed to the Heavenly Father. I've seen statements, but this is a question. There's a difference between a statement and a question. And I searched and I searched throughout the entire scripture. This stands as a sole question. Jesus directed to the Heavenly Father. And despite its simplicity, this question unveils Jesus' unwavering faith in the divine purpose ordained by his Heavenly Father. Notably, Jesus addresses the Father as God. He didn't say Heavenly Father, he said, my God, repetition. So Jesus addresses the Father as God, Yahweh, underscoring his reverence and acknowledgement of divine authority. By using the word God, he's underscoring his reverence and acknowledgement of divine authority. And even in the depths of feeling forsaken, Jesus refrains from casting blame and accusation. He intimately addresses the Father as, my God, my God, my God, simplifying a deeply personal connection that remains unshakable, even amid apparent separation. It is as though he declares, my God, though you seem distant, your will must prevail, my God. Though you seem distant in this hour, in this moment, your will must prevail. And in this profound moment, a darkness pervades not only the skies over Jerusalem, but also the depths of Christ's soul. And there is a sound dwellings from heaven, which is unlike previous times. Because other times, heaven responded. This time, heaven didn't respond. There was a silence from heaven, unlike previous times. And let me just show you just an example of previous times. When Jesus was baptized, the Father spoke. After Jesus fasted 40 days and 40 nights in the desert and was tempted by the devil, the angels came and ministered unto him. After he had prayed till sweat drops as blood fell from his brow in the Garden of Gethsemane, the angels came and ministered unto him. But no one answers him now. There is a silence. There is silence from heaven. There is silence from heaven. Now, why did heaven not answer Jesus from the cross? Is your next question. Why did heaven not answer Jesus from the cross? Heaven does not answer Jesus because he identified with you and with me. Answer simple. There's no gotcha. Heaven does not answer Jesus because he identified with you and with me. He became sin. He bore our sin. Jesus became so much one with us that he, like you, could ask the question, why? Humanity stepped in. Because this is a human question. Like I said, we ask the questions, why? This is a human question. And Jesus took all the questions of anguish of the world and wrapped it up in that one question, why? This is the one moment where humanity stepped in. Because as you can see before, he wasn't in a human state of mind. Because when Jesus was falsely tried, he spoke not a word. Because many of you are saying, well, how can you say that that's when Jesus was falsely tried, he spoke not a word. When he was beaten with the cat o' nine tails, he never uttered a word. When they pressed the crown of thorns into his brow, he never said a word. When they nailed his hands to the cross, he spoke nothing. Now, however, he speaks. He actually cries out from the cross. Let me go a little further. In all of these instances, he had not reached the pinnacle of suffering. And these were horrific, agonizing moments that I just mentioned. When he was beaten with a cat o' nine, that's horrific. When they pressed the crown of thorns into his brow, that was horrific. When they nailed his hands on the cross, it was horrific. And he experienced anguish. But he had not reached the pinnacle of suffering until. There's an until. Until his father forsook him. And for Jesus, the pinnacle of suffering was his abandonment by the Father. His abandonment by the Father. When God turned his back on Jesus, Our Lord cried out. You see, Jesus had been forsaken by his own family. He had been forsaken by his disciples, but he had not been forsaken by his Father until this moment on the cross. His Father turned his back on him. And this moment was more than Jesus could. So he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? To reiterate, there was a separation, our disruption that occurred within the two members of Trinity, the Father and the Son. There was a separation between the union of divine nature and human nature. Ooh. There was a separation. And Jesus had not known great pain and suffering, both physical and emotionally, during his life. Yet he had never known separation, because he had known great pain. He had known great pain and suffering, but he had never known separation or alienation from God the Father. He's never known that until this very moment. He knew pain. He knew rejection. He knew mockery. He knew all of that. He knew betrayal. Emotional and physical pain, he knew. But he had never known separation or alienation from God, his Father. And at this moment, he experienced what he had not yet ever experienced. Now, why was Jesus forsaken? I told you before, Jesus was made sin for you and for me. He was made sin for us. He was made sin. And this alone explains why the Father would turn his back on his own Son. Because in Psalms 22 and verse 3, the scripture says, thou art holy. In Habakkuk 1 verse 13, the Bible declares, thou art of purer eyes than to behold evil. In Isaiah 59 verse 2, it says, your iniquities have separated you between you and your God. So God is too pure to look upon sin. And in the moment when Jesus was made sin, the Father could not look upon his Son. So Jesus' cry on the cross is a prayer to his Father. Whom he trust. And it's not a sense of despair. And he prayed, my God, twice, which shows personal trust. He said, my God, because he held on to his faith in the Father. He was essentially saying, my God, you have forsaken me, but I know you are still my Father, my God. God, you are forsaken. But I know you are still my Father, my God. We must have the same kind of faith. Because Jesus held on. Because of his dedication to his Father. He held on because of his dedication to his mission. He held on because of his dedication to you and to me. Say that again. He held on because of his dedication to his father. He held on because of his dedication to his mission and the assignment that was upon his life. He held on because of his dedication to you and to me. So over 2,000 years ago, Jesus left heaven to come to this earth to seek and to save that which is lost. Jesus left heaven to come to this earth to seek and to save that which is lost. And John 3:17 sums it all up. That he came not to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. I want you to know this morning that Bethlehem was not the end of the path. At the temple was not the end of the path. Healing, teaching, blessing were not the end of the path. The insults and the sorrows, the false trials and being nailed to the cross were still not the end of the path. Because to reach the lost sheep of Luke 15, he had to go all the way to the end. So finally, he came to the end of the path. He came to the place where being forsaken by his father was a reality. That is where the sinner is. Jesus went to that place to reach the lost sheep. It was his path. Jesus went to that place to reach the lost sheep. That lost sheep was you. That lost sheep was me. And that was his path. He experienced what God did for us. And you and I this morning should be in awe of God's love for us that is found in the cross when Jesus hung and he took on our sin and he paid the price for you and for me. In closing, God's love for us is unchanging. It's unchanging. It never changes. Romans 5, verse 6 through 8 says, for while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous man, though perhaps for a good man, a good person, one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. While we're still sinners, Christ died for you and for me. He died for you and for me. Jesus was not ignorant and not knowing why he was being crucified. It is a why. It was his why that highlights and amplifies what God did to redeem us back to himself. for our salvation. The Lord is calling those who have never trusted Jesus to believe on him today. He's calling you and me. He's calling the lost today. He's calling the lukewarm today because you're lost too. The ones that are between two opinions are the lukewarms. He died for your sins and for mine. And the greatest day of my life was when I trusted him to be my Savior. There is no other day that was greater or can be compared. Yes, when I got married, that was the happiest day. When I had my children, but the greatest day of my life was when I trusted him to be my Savior. It was sealed in eternity. He gave me life that day, life eternal. Because he paid a price for me that I could never repay. So today, as this sermon, it's engrafted in your heart and in your mind. Won't you accept him and fully accept him today? He's calling you. He's calling you. He says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. The sacrificial lamb is calling today. His arms are wide open, saying, come to me, and I will give you rest. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. There's nothing too hard for him. Just trust him. Just put your hand in his hand, and he will lead you all the way. I pray that this word today, you receive it. And as you receive his word, receive him. Receive him. Receive him today. He's calling you. He's calling you. He paid the price. He paid the price that you and I could have never paid. His path led him all the way. Jesus went to that place to reach the lost sheep. That was his path. And he went all the way. All the way to Calvary he went for me. All the way to Calvary he went for you. And he's calling you today. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we conclude today, we are reminded of your promise. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. We are thankful for the invitation to find solace and peace in your presence. Lord, we surrender our burdens to you, trusting that you are our refuge and strength. I pray that we carry with us the assurance that you are always near, ready to offer comfort and renewal to our weary souls. Help us, Lord, to rest in your love and find strength in your grace. Guide us as we navigate the challenges of life, knowing that you are our source of strength and peace. As the words that were released into our hearts today, I pray that your people are reminded of the profound words spoken by Jesus on the cross. My God, why have you forsaken me? In those moments of deep anguish, your son experienced the weight of separation from you, bearing the full burdens of our sins. Lord, we're grateful for the sacrifice Jesus made on our behalf. Help us to comprehend the depth of his love and the magnitude of his sacrifice. I pray that his cry on the cross serve as a constant reminder of your unfailing love for us, even in our darkest moments. I pray that we carry with us the assurance that nothing can separate us from your love. Grant us the courage to face life challenges with faith and perseverance, knowing that you're always with us, even in our moments of doubt and despair. Today, we thank you, Lord, for the redemption and hope we find in you. Thank you for your faithfulness and for the rest you offer to all who seek you. I pray that the sacrifice, this sacrifice, inspire us to live a life of gratitude, knowing that you did not do this only but to save us. I pray that your peace, which surpasses all understanding, guide our hearts and mind as we trust you like never before. As we turn our lives over to you, God, as we surrender our all to you, I pray that today will be a transformation in the lives of your children, where we will not look at another Easter season like we have in the past, but we found new meaning in the sacrifice that you made, just so that we can have access. And access is granted. And access is granted. I thank you today for your love. I thank you for your pouring out. I thank you, Lord, for loving us. Your unconditional love. Your agape love. I give you thanks and I give you praise. And I seal this prayer in the name of the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Ghost. Amen and amen. If you receive him today, ReCharge Ministries, our doors are open for you. All you have to do is send me a chat, and we will pray for you. The Lord is saying, my arms are outstretched. Won't you come? Won't you come? May God bless and keep you. I pray that you put this message on replay to remind you of the sacrifice, the sacrificial lamb made for you and for me. God bless you. God bless you. And may his face shine
upon you. God bless you, everybody.